This is Will Friedle, the voice of the future Dark Knight, Batman Beyond, and you're listening to the DCAU Review, hosted by Cal and Liam, streaming at DCAUReview.com and on your favorite podcast app. And remember a few things. First, Dana deserves better. And second, I am Batman.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to episode 191 of the DCAU Review. I am one of your hosts, Cal, and with me, my good friend, good brother, the man that runs our Twitter account. That's right, Liam. Liam, welcome to a new year. It's 2022. Granted, we had our first episode last week, but we were still focused on the year for our podcast in 2021. So welcome to the first new episode of 2022, where we're covering uncharted territory here as we return to the future.
The future, Cal.
That's right. All the way to the year 2039 or 49 or 50 years from now, whenever now is. Whatever you prefer.
That is right. We are, in fact, talking about Batman Beyond for the next couple weeks here. And we have a we're picking up right where we left off. I believe the DVDs and Blu-rays and the HBO Max episode order is actually air date order rather than production order like the original animated series are. But we are watching in the order that it is available to us, and we are picking up with the episode April Moon.
Yes, an episode that I gotta be honest, when I pulled it up, I was like, I don't remember watching this one too many times. I don't remember this episode very well. And as you would have it, going through the episode, I think this might be an episode that I maybe have seen twice in my life or something like that, because I didn't remember a lot of the plot points. I definitely didn't remember the ending. And it's also maybe for the better that I didn't, but we'll get into that when we go through our review here. As you mentioned, this 191st edition of the DCAU Review covering April Moon, which originally aired back on the Kids WB back on April the 22nd, 2000, meaning we're coming up on the 22-year anniversary of this episode's air date.
All the way to the year 2000 is what you're saying.
That's right. Absolutely. But hey, before we get into our review today, let's fill in the listeners with a little bit of IMDb synopsis, the yet sponsored IMDb synopsis segment here on the DCAU Review. The first one of the year 2022, shall we?
That's right. This is the year we're gonna get that IMDb sponsorship before 2022 is over. That's my number one goal. But yes, this is the IMDb synopsis for April Moon, which was written by Stan Berkowitz and James Tucker, directed by Butch Lukic, with music by Michael McQuestion and animation by Coco and Dong Yang. And that synopsis reads as such. Batman must battle a gang of cyborgs made possible by blackmailing a bionic specialist. That is like a D minus, because that makes it sound like Batman is blackmailing the bionic specialist.
Which is absolutely not what happens in the least bit. So I guess, Liam, we might as well jump into the plot here. And yeah, there is a doctor that's involved and a scientist, but that's not where we start off. We start off with sort of this introduction to this gang who we have never met before, that are breaking and entering, and have announced that they are the new kings of Gotham, and they are ready to take over.
Opening night jitters.
He's scared, Harold. That's what it is.
Shut up. Yeah. We got no reason to be scared. We're not punk kids anymore. We're special. We're gonna own this city. And here are the keys.
Woo-hoo, yeah!
Yo, thanks, Harold.
You know, I never liked that name. I need something more appropriate now. Like, Bull Whip.
Woo-hoo!
You're up.
Thank you. You keep watch.
We're not quite sure exactly what leads them to have such cockiness, because they appear to be just regular teens or young adults. And wouldn't you have it as they're prepared to do their break-in, the main star, who we learn his original name was Harold, but now goes by the pseudonym Bullwhip, pulls his sleeve up a little bit and reveals something that looks a little bit like a web shooter, but we'll talk about that in visuals, but instead shoots out a mechanical whip at this point. And he uses this to break an entering, and he and his crew of other members, who actually go unnamed throughout the episode, but we do get names in the credits, reveal their cybernetic enhancements as well. And each of them with a different gifting. And as they do break an entering, however, they are met by the future Dark Knight himself. That's right. Batman shows up to stop what's happening. And we get our first sort of clash between the hero of our program and these new dastardly gang of villains.
Yeah, this kind of creates the pattern of the episode here, which is Batman fights this gang. Mostly to a standstill. He does injure once. So, and again, we'll probably go over more of the stuff in visuals, but they're so they all have their different weapons in this gang. As you mentioned, the one guy has these sort of wrist gauntlet cables that he can shoot out and use like whips. One of them has like a suit of armor, sort of like a rhino type suit that he can surround his body in. One of the guys had like big giant metal like piston punching or boxing gloves.
Depending on the scene, they're either pistons or fists, because that changes.
Yes. Yeah, seemingly at random. And then we have the fourth guy, who is like, he's got buzzsaw knees for some reason. He has buzzsaws on his hands. Okay, that makes sense. And then he also has them on his knees, and it's his undoing in like two or three of the fight scenes. He either gets caught or it gets damaged and broken.
It's such a vulnerable area to place these buzzsaws. Yes.
Right on like the knee joint, right where it bends. He has giant buzzsaws shooting out of his leg. So questionable choice by our aforementioned Dr. Corso, who we will learn a little bit more about. But yes, Batman is sort of defeated by the gang and is able to take a piece from Buzzsaw guy, and has Bruce look at it, where they sort of look at it and see that it reminds Bruce of the same sort of hardware that's wired into the bat suit, and he realizes that he ordered those parts from a specialist called Dr. Corso.
Looks like the servo motors in my costume.
Exactly like them. I bought yours years ago from a doctor who specialized in prosthetics for people who'd lost limbs. His name was Peter Corso, and this is definitely one of his.
Looks like the good doctor isn't so good anymore.
I'm gonna do some tests on this motor. There's something odd about the circuitry. And I suggest you go make a house call.
And that, of course, leads us to the doctor of the episode that we've been talking about. And we find out that he is sort of being held hostage by this gang, although not directly. He's, under duress. He is helping this gang. And so he repairs. Here's another thing. And yeah, I think you may have said this already, but they all have like wacky supervillain names, but none of them are mentioned in the episode except for Bullwhips.
Correct.
So I have to look up.
Knee jerk is the one with the knees for saw, or saws for knees.
I think Buzzsaw Guy is a better name, honestly. Like anything. I mean, which one would look better on a comic? I'm just telling you.
Right.
I think Buzzsaw Guy would look better.
Bonesaw? I think Bonesaw would have been a perfect nod to that era. They would have beaten Spider-Man to the punch too for having a villain named Bonesaw.
But yes, so he makes his repairs, and as we said, Terry and Bruce sort of discover that this doctor's handiwork is afoot when it comes to these new sort of cybernetic villains. And so Terry goes to see the good doctor, confronts him, asks him why he would help him. And Terry, which to be fair, he does admit to this, But what an idiot. What an idiot. He just stands there and lets himself get injected with any kind of substance. Also, what's the bat suit made out of?
I was literally about like to say needle. That. Yep. There's like, we know that there's at least a half an inch of cybernetics in between the outer part of the costume, which I get it. Maybe it's like a, you know, I couldn't even tell you what type of material. It's made of some sort of material, though, because we know that it gets damaged, mm-hmm. gets ripped. We've seen that happen on multiple occasions where it's been damaged. But underneath of it, there has to be at least a half an inch of of electronics and cybernetics. So whatever the doctor has in this sedative gun that he administers to Terry unbeknownst to him or surprisingly is able to penetrate not only the layer of material that's on the outside of the bat suit, which we've seen is pretty durable for as much damage and as many mm-hmm. fights as Terry has. It's not like every time he fights it gets damaged either. It's only in specific episodes, so it's pretty durable. And then the cybernetics underneath of it are extremely durable too, so whatever it was penetrated all of those layers and Terry's skin and was able to fully knock him unconscious. And as you mentioned, he does own mm-hmm. it and acknowledge that he's a bit of an idiot for allowing himself to be taken by surprise. But hey, maybe he assumed the bat suit would protect him from it. I don't know.
Oh, no. This is what an idiot looks like, Max. I let him trick me, and then while I was out, he moved his whole operation. Never gonna find him.
Ter, you're forgetting something. While you were unconscious, he had a perfect chance to get rid of you for good, but he didn't. What's that tell you?
That maybe he's not such a bad guy after all.
Let's find out.
Anyway, but as he awakens, we learn that, as he's sort of commiserating with Max and sharing the fact that he feels like he's an idiot, Max points out the fact that, hey, Dr. Corso clearly didn't want you dead because he could have made you dead at that point or caused you to mm-hmm. die at that point. So he must be okay. Maybe you should go find him and figure out a way to, you know, to get a hold of him. Now, here's the other part, the other hole in this story. So we learn, and there's sort of this alluding to that they have something they're holding over the doctor, that the gang is, in order to keep him in their service and to keep them at their beck and call. If you look closely in the first scene that we see Dr. Corso, when the gang shows up with Knee Jerk to get repaired, there is a photo of a young lady on his nightstand. So you can kind of already draw conclusions as to what's going on here, but right. It's not clearly spelled out till later on when Terry figures out the best way to get a hold of the doctor is to call him up and not use a tracing device to figure out where the cell phone is, because we've also seen that technology readily available to Terry and Bruce. Hey, let's go find out where this guy is. No, we have to set up a sting where we lure him away from where he is in order to find out what the story is. So Terry lures him as Batman in one of the most hilarious scenes. Batman is hiding under a blanket, not using his invisibility cloak that he has, but hiding under a blanket in order to lure the doctor into the room, and then springs out and quickly shakes the doctor down for as much information as possible. And then we get the doctor going into full detail about how this gang has kidnapped the love of his life. And he doesn't just tell us that they've kidnapped the love of his life. He also goes into the full story of how she became the love of his life. Mm-hmm. And that's where things get a little weird. I'm not going to lie. It feels very strange. We go into full detail about how his first interaction with this April is her showing up as his new nurse and offering him a bowl of cereal, Flaky Flakes, that is.
Dr. Corso. Good morning. I'm your new nurse, April. I thought you might want some breakfast.
Flaky Flakes? They're for children, aren't they?
I have a feeling you've never tried them, even when you were a child yourself.
It's that obvious, huh? Hmm. Not bad.
See what you've been missing?
That's how it started, with a bowl of cereal. It only took me a couple of weeks to make up my mind about her. April, could you please clean this?
It is such a weird, like, 90 seconds of television as they show. Yeah, she brings him cereal and he insists that no, this cereal is for children, and she says, well, you should try it. Like, it felt like an ad, like an early 90s or like late 80s television. If you ever look up like old like commercials for, you know, like this would be a commercial for like Frosted Flakes or something,
right?
But yeah, and then we sort of just cut to, I guess, months later, years later, hard to tell. And he's in love with her. And he,
I think he said within a few weeks. He decided within a few weeks, I think, is the throwaway line that he had.
Okay. So I don't know. Yeah, I wasn't sure if that meant that he was proposing to her a few weeks later, if that was just like when
he had just made up his mind. Yeah. Gotcha.
But to your point, it could very well be even less time than that. But either way, it didn't look like he had aged at all. So it looked like it was pretty current anyway. But yeah, so he had proposed, they had apparently been married, and then after performing a operation on this guy Harold, who later becomes Bullwhip, he sort of asked if he's interested in sort of helping upgrade Harold and some of his other friends, and he of course at first says no, he's not interested, he doesn't care about the money, that he couldn't live with himself for helping people commit crimes and all that. So of course he comes home to a ransacked house, his wife April nowhere to be found, and so under duress he is now helping this gang and has given them all of these sort of special cybernetic superpowers to try to take over Gotham and take down Batman. So yeah, it's just I am so exasperated by this, because then the rest of the episode is just, as you mentioned, it's just like Batman tricking this guy via the blanket, and then the gang shows up to confront the Doctor and Batman. Batman appears to get bested again and run away, at which point he was actually playing possum, and we find out, and the bad guys leave, and Batman's following them back to the hideout. But in the meanwhile, Bruce lets him know a little bit of important information, which is that these servos that like the one that Terry found and that's in the bat suit and that is apparently inside all of the technology of these special cybernetic upgrades, they have a kill switch that if you say them, they will self-destruct. And so Terry is told by Bruce that he just needs to find a special code word, and all he knows is that it would probably be a word not said in normal conversation, and also a phrase or word that would have special significance to the Doctor. So that sort of sets up our final confrontation as Terry arrives, and right before he can sort of take on the thugs, the Doctor also arrives. Apparently everyone here just is completely unaware of their being followed also, because Terry follows the gang back with no problem, and then this Doctor followed the Batmobile again with no problem.
If only so. There was some sort of cloaking device that anybody could have used to prevent prevent them from easily being seen. But yeah, and we get to the hideout, and that's where we get the big reveal, shocker of shockers, that this April is actually in on the whole thing and is using the gang to extort the Doctor and is a part of it, I guess. It's not really made clear why or her motivation for the bait and switch and why she whether it was always part of the plan to seduce this doctor and she was in like in cahoots with Harold the whole time, or if it was something that came about afterwards. It's very not clear to me whether or not it was all part of it, or whether it was, you know, intended to be from the start. She does make a comment about how once they have like the spoils of one of their robberies given to them at some jewels, Harold says something about, oh, you know, has the doctor ever given you something as nice as this? And she said, he would never, or he could never give me something this nice, or something, which makes you think that's like, okay, she really didn't ever like this doctor, and it was just seducing him in order for him to be to have leverage to blackmail him to give these biological upgrades. I don't know.
Looks like it's working so far, doesn't it? You gotta tell me the secret word?
So you figured it out. Doesn't matter. I told you before, I don't want you trying to rescue her. If anything happened to her, I don't know what I'd...
So what'd you bring me? Hope it's something good.
Just a little number I picked up this morning. Bet the doc never gave you anything like this.
He could never afford to.
You got anything for me? Somebody's out there. There he is.
Yeah, well, that's interesting, though, because I think the way the flashback is ordered, he meets April first.
Right.
And then they show him meeting Bullwhip. And Bullwhip asking him to do, you know, the special upgrades or whatever. So within the like the linear way we are told this story, it would appear that he met and fell in love with and married April 1st, and then Bullwhip came into his life, but that's not explicitly clear. And it could be because they kind of just say like she just showed up one day. So yeah, she could have been in it from the start, or maybe it's just it's just an outdated perception of like all women are are gold diggers or something like that. I don't know. There's not really like a moral to the story, as we'll get to. As Terry and the doctor see Bullwhip and April kissing, and that sort of throws the doctor off the deep end. He starts making noise, which the gang hears, and that creates sort of the final showdown as Terry sort of shoves the doctor down into a cellar and then takes on the bad guys. And right when it looks like maybe Terry is once again in over his head, he realizes the code phrase must be this song that the doctor mentions. It's a real song. I think it's from the year 1990. Mm-hmm. It's called April. I believe it's called April Moon, and it is by Sam Brown. So that is a real song that is referenced here. But we have that code phrase is what is in fact the self-destruct key. So we get a scene of Terry sort of avoiding an attack from each of the gang, with the exception of Bullwhip, and then uttering that phrase April Moon over and over again, and watching some kind of, this is another example of like, even though these guys aren't fully robots, we sort of take advantage of the ability to dismember them.
Right.
Because they're, although really the Buzzsaw guy seems to be the one that really was like an amputee. Everyone else just looks like they had like extra stuff put on them.
Right, exactly.
So yeah. But Knee Jerk certainly gets it the worst, as his forearms, hands, and then everything below his knees just falls off, and he's sort of laying there. And then yes, he takes care of the other two as well, and Bullwhip seemingly gets away, and then we cut to Terry and Bruce in Wayne Manor, and they are discussing that Terry is saying like, yeah, I just kind of gave up looking. I didn't find him, and I didn't really try to look for them or for the doctor. My heart wasn't in it. And Bruce is like, yeah, I get that. And then Bruce asks, oh, is the doctor, did the doctor, or does Bullwhip know that the doctor knows that he stole April from him? And Terry says no. And Bruce is like, well, maybe we won't be seeing the doctor then. And then it cuts to Bullwhip about to go under the knife, as it were, for surgery one more time. And he's asking, you know, demanding upgrades and telling the doctor that if he just does these few more things that April will be back to him in no time. And then we sort of cut to a POV shot of Bullwhip as the doctor holds a power drill towards the camera, and we fade to black. And that is the end of all of these characters.
Thank the Lord.
And when I went back to the cellar, the doctor was gone. I guess I should have spent more time looking for him, but my heart wasn't in it.
I understand. What about April and Bullwhip?
Gone too. Both of them.
They'll be back. They always come back. Tell me something, though. Does Bullwhip know that the doctor saw him with April?
No way. By the time he came out of the townhouse, I'd already put the doctor in the cellar.
Then maybe Bullwhip won't be coming back.
Why do you say that?
I sure am glad you didn't leave town, Doc.
I couldn't.
Oh, yeah, April. Don't worry. She's doing fine. Can't wait to see you again.
Uh-huh.
You do this one last thing for me, and she's all yours.
Uh-huh.
But don't just repair me. Make me stronger, less vulnerable, too. And don't hold back. Understand?
I understand. No holding back.
All right. Time to get into our scores here, now that we've done a full recap. Okay. This episode is awful. I don't like this episode at all. Yeah, I don't know what they were like. We know it's interesting because I think the DCAU wiki only gives the writing credit to Stan Berkowitz, not to James Tucker, which is interesting because I think IMDb gives it to the both of them.
So it's credited on the actual episode as story by Stan Berkowitz and James Tucker. And I think teleplay or written by is just Stan Berkowitz, which I assume means that the name on the actual script of the dialogue of the episode is Stan Berkowitz, but it was a story that was the two of them working it out, is my understanding.
All right. So before I guess I completely tear this apart, let me just say, obviously both of these gentlemen have written amazing Batman and DCAU cartoons. So sometimes you're not going to bat 1,000. Like we've seen that even with some of the greatest writers in the series, you're not going to bat 1,000 every time. Sometimes the episodes are not going to be good. I think there are interesting elements here that somebody that's being blackmailed to use modern technology to do upgrades, and then having the femme fatale be the key, and then her turning on, you know, the person that's being blackmailed. It's a very old and used, it's a story beat that's been used a lot. So maybe that's why it just feels very tired, that's the big reveal. It's, oh, just kidding. April's not actually in love. This young, beautiful woman is not actually in love with the old doctor that never had flaky flakes. She's just using him for his technology and as a way to, you know, as leverage so that her real boyfriend can, you know, continue to get technology upgrades for free. I think the characters are interesting. I think having the knee, I don't understand the saws for kneecaps guy. I don't understand knee jerk. I think it would have been interesting to see some of these characters on their own, maybe one or two. One of the things that I kept coming back to was, if you're going to do this and the character actually somewhat resembles him, we'll talk about it in visuals in just a second. But if you're going to do this story this way, why not give it some stakes? Make the lead guy, make Harold Willie Watt instead of a brand new character that we have no attachment to. It bring back one of the rogues from season one. You bring back Willie Watt, who does have this weird sort of connection to technology and telekinesis and the other things that he had happen to him. Then at least there's some sort of stakes to this, and at the end you're like, oh my gosh, they're killing Willie Watt, that's crazy. I do not care about any of these characters. It feels very much like justice is served at the end for Bullwhip getting his brain drilled in or whatever happens to him off screen. And I don't necessarily know how I'm supposed to feel about Dr. Corso, because he's obviously he's not on the good side here, but he's also being blackmailed for this woman that he does love and didn't do anything wrong with. It's just, and then as you said, Terry and Bruce just sort of very acting very out of character and not like Batman. I don't know. I don't know how to like how to quantify this episode in a way and spin it in a positive light. I can't.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's the weirdest thing to me is that it is an episode with two people that we know are responsible for some incredible stories, not just within this DC animated universe, but both prolific writers. James Tucker, obviously, also, you know, very creative when it came to character design and directing and producing these shows. So it's like, and Stan Berkowitz, a longtime writer on Superman and Batman and Beyond and Justice League, and like, so you know these guys are generally pretty safe bets when it comes to their stories, to their episodes. But man, like, this is just, it's straight. I think just the pacing of it in general, like I said, it's like, it's a series of like Batman goes to the doctor gets away, and then Batman just calls the doctor and the doctor goes to him and Batman does the sting, and then the bad guys get away again, but actually Batman was just hiding. It's just like, it's just a very like, and they, it's sort of cut up with those scenes of Terry talking to Bruce or to Max, but it just doesn't feel like, yeah, it just feels kind of low stakes. And then, yeah, that twist is, I mean, theoretically it's fine, but it doesn't really feel like it has that much impact, just because, like you said, we didn't know who these characters were before 5 minutes ago. So right. when it's not like we've had any length of time to really care about the doctor or to care about his wife or his life being ruined here or whatever. So yeah, overall, I was definitely like, I think there's an interesting idea here as far as like, you know, a doctor creating, you know, prosthetic cybernetic weapons for bad guys and stuff like that. I think that's an interesting idea, but just the execution of it just left so much to be desired. And, I actually ended up giving it a 4 out of 10 for plot.
Well, you are a lot more generous than I was for this, because I gave the plot a 2 out of 10 for this wow. episode. It's not good. I've already talked about most of the things that I don't like about it, but I just don't get when you have your hero also, like, Batman gets his ass handed to him for 3/4 of this episode and really only figures it out by this, oh, it must be April Moon. That's the secret combo. And how he defeats the heroes is just whispering it like softly in their ears, like, April Moon. Like, that's the culmination of this destruction. And while it's cool to see these Rector set people fall apart, like after he says it, it's really not a good payoff, and it doesn't leave your hero feeling like he really did anything to win. And you had your antagonist get away, at least one of them get away, and we don't know really what happens to April, and the doctor murders somebody. So it's really not a feel good ending.
Yeah, I also just think like the sort of clunky way with which they introduced the term April Moon into the episode, I also think it's kind of funny, because like that song, it, like we said, it's a real song, but it's not like some all-time classic song. So the idea that Terry 50 years from now, whenever now is, would be like, ah, an April, a reasonably common name for a woman to have. Ah, like that song that no one has ever heard of, April Moon. Like, just so that at the end he could figure it out. Like, it would have been better at least if the doctor offered that up first, instead of Terry being like, ah, yes, like that song, and the doctor being like, yes, we very much liked that song. I thought that execution was clunky, and just so you could have a moment where Terry has his aha moment and figures out how to stop the bad guys. But yeah, I don't know. It's like I said, I think there's a nugget of an interesting idea as far as like gimmicks for villains, but I feel like either you should have just had the doctor be in on it and be a bad guy and sort of be the ringleader of it, or some other twist in the episode besides the fact that his wife, who we again only knew for a few minutes is actually a bad guy. It wasn't a great reveal. And some of that maybe comes down to you only having 22 minutes to tell your story. But again, we review great episodes that only have 22 minutes to tell their story all the time, including ones written by James Tucker and Stan Berkowitz. So I'm not really sure what happened this time, but yeah, rough day at the office.
For sure. Let's move on to our second category of the day, Liam, which is going to be our animation and visuals. That, of course, as you mentioned, done by Coco and Dong Yang, which means it's a pretty solid episode when it comes to visuals. As we mentioned, some of the fun comes from the actual gang or these four individuals and their bionic upgrades. As we mentioned, the cables. I was trying to figure out if these were some like sort of homages to X-Men characters, maybe. Like, I feel like maybe it's too spot on to have the dude with cables. Obviously, Cable is an X-Men character, but you know, they have somewhat similarities. The one guy reminded me of a Juggernaut type character. Obviously, he runs through a wall. He's got a big outer shell that he kind of contains himself into. But maybe these are homages. They were also all different colors, which also made me think, I don't know if it was, I don't know if there was significance to any of these things. I didn't see anybody admit to it or any commentary saying that they were direct homages to certain characters maybe or other properties. But they all have their unique gifting, so to speak. As you mentioned, we have Bullwhip. He's got the metallic whips that shoot out of these gauntlets from his wrists. We have Knee Jerk, as we mentioned already multiple times, has the buzzsaws that come not only out of his kneecaps, but also his hands as well. Mm-hmm. Then we also have Terrapin. That's the gentleman who has a full body of armor, an Iron Man-esque or a Juggernaut-esque suit of armor that sort of launches and encases him in an inner shell there. And then of course we have Nux also. So Nux is the one who it looked like they couldn't decide when they were storyboarding what his powers were or how they worked. In the first scene, they're just flat pistons on the end of his arms, and they're sort of just attached to his arms. He's got pistons for arms. Then later on, as we mentioned, they're sort of metallic Hulk hands essentially. Mm-hmm. that are attached to this shoulder apparatus, and then they change back into pistons, and then they're back into fists later on. So there was definitely some inconsistency there. What stuck out for you other than those four as far as visuals were concerned?
Not a lot. I do like all the designs as far as the, I still don't understand the buzzsaws in the knees, but otherwise, like, I think all of those guys look cool. And, you know, I like the visualization. I don't feel like there's, and again, we don't really get the other members of the team don't really have much dialogue. So we don't really get a feel for like, oh, these weapons that they have are sort of like an element of their personality, like you maybe see with like something like the Fantastic Four, where, you know, each member of the team kind of has, you know, of their power is sort of somehow indicative of their personality in some ways or something like that. I don't really get that feeling. Like I said, Bullwhip is the leader and does the lion's share of the talking, and it's sort of the main villain of the episode. And like I said, I like all their powers. I think Terrapin is probably the most memorable, the most toyetic, if we're talking about that side of things. As you said, like an Iron Man or like a kind of like a Rhino type, just big armored up guy who's just kind of running headfirst towards Batman over and over again. I think those visuals are cool. The fights that Batman has with those guys are okay. I don't think any of them are great. I think probably the standout moment is that final fight where he's using the code phrase to break all of their limbs and their weapons. I think that's kind of a fun sequence there, as the suits or the metal sort of slowly falls off their bodies or something like that. But yeah, I wasn't really particularly, and again, it's a lot of talking. Otherwise, it's Terry talking to Bruce. It's the Doctor talking to Bullwhip and the rest of the bad guys. It's like we said, we get this strange flashback of the Doctor and April meeting for the first time and all this stuff. So yeah, I think from an action standpoint, that, like I said, I think those fights are fun, and I like the visuals of all of those guys. But my only other note is here is that I wonder if Dr. Corso's was based on Ted Danson.
Wait, why do you say that?
he's got like the long face. Like it's like it's in his face, and he's got kind of like the swooped back hair. That's good. Just kind of honestly though, maybe not, because Ted Danson probably still didn't have like white hair in the year 2000.
I feel like he's had white hair for forever. He's been dying it since like the
probably
Becker days or whatever. That was that the name of that's Becker?
I believe so.
Ted Danson comedy. Man, we're deep diving here on 1990 late 90s comedy sitcoms here. Ooh,
that's right. You want to talk about a show that had no impact on the zeitgeist but somehow ran for like 8 years? Look up Becker. But that was my other thought. It's like I think the Doctor is maybe supposed to look like someone, and April herself, I thought maybe, I don't know, like it's a gorgeous sort of DCAU Bruce Timm style blonde, so I'm always like, is this supposed to look like, is this, it's not quite Marilyn Monroe, it could be another actress,
right?
Or it could be based off another comic character that I'm not thinking of. But yeah, like I think the episode is as we've already talked about, sort of narratively lacking, and like I said, I think there are some fun fights. Mm-hmm. And I like the visual design of the bad guys, but there's nothing really to me that's like standout spectacular. So yeah, for all those reasons, I ended up giving visuals and animation a 6 out of 10.
Yeah, that's the same score I settled on, also a 6 out of 10. I think I could have been probably a lot meaner to this score, and I chose not to be. There are a couple of errors continuity wise, as we already mentioned, with the inconsistencies in the one character's in Nux's weapons, that's weird. There was some misspellings in the background, in the scene where they're in the hotel. You can see the sign is spelled incorrectly. That's not on the animation as much it is, I think they outsourced those backgrounds sometimes. So, or most times, some of those backgrounds were outsourced, so it was just a miscommunication, but there's definitely a misspelling or two. So yeah, I think we could have been a lot harsher. There isn't anything I think that is terribly off model. I think mostly everything looks okay. Bruce looked, in that last scene where they're in Wayne Manor, I thought it was lit very oddly. We're not usually, I feel like it was lit with like reds and golds almost, and it was just a very odd lighting that you're not used to seeing in Wayne Manor. So that did throw that scene off a little bit for me, but that's fine. You're going to do something different and have a different setting than you're usually than just sitting them in the cave. That's fine, I guess. But yeah, not a whole lot of things here to champion or to be excited about in an episode that already was sort of being dragged down by the plot. So let's move on to our next category, Liam, which is going to be music. This is an episode that is right off the bat, I felt something was off, and I was like, what is weird about this episode? And from the very beginning, they chose to score this with a traditional Batman the Animated Series horns and flutes soundtrack for some reason. And it feels very weird. In places, they do kind of bring in some of the more traditional Beyond instruments towards the end with the synthesizer, I felt like I heard, and a little bit of guitar, but it's a lot of the more traditional elements, which I felt like would have made sense specifically for the flashback scene, perhaps, if you want to make it, you know, a more romantic, more heartwarming scene as this couple is falling in love. That sort of made sense to me. But to score some of the fight scenes, particularly that initial fight scene, it just sounds out of place with what I'm watching on the screen for me. I don't know how you felt about it.
Yeah, I think it's, I think it works sometimes to that, because yeah, it is very, it's very like string and horn focused. It's very kind of like bluesy and jazzy. It almost has like this like film noir, like if this were like a detective story where like maybe Terry was narrating this mystery that he was working on and or something, and it had this real like this sort of noir feel to it, or this detective story feel to it, that would kind of make sense as a stylistic choice. But as just what this is, which is it's mostly just presented as your run-of-the-mill episode of Batman Beyond, it was an odd choice to just have this very traditional sort of like string, as you said, strings and horns. I think the music, if you just listen to the music like in a vacuum, I think it's good. Like I think it's memorable, it catches your ear for sure. Michael McQuestion, the composer here. But I don't know that I feel like it fits this story particularly well.
Yeah, it just felt out of place. And like I said, I think if it had been isolated to maybe just that flashback of the Dr. Corso telling the story, then I think it would have felt a little more suited for it. But when you have this is well into season two of Batman Beyond at this point, so we have an established way that most of the music sounds. So if you're going to deviate from that for an episode, I feel like it needs to have a little more something to it too. Doesn't feel like there's a catchy riff that goes throughout, to make this episode stand out, sort of like you did with some of the older Batman the Animated Series episodes, where if you're going to deviate from the normal soundtrack of just generic horns and you're going to make the soundtrack itself stand out, there has to be something, a reason I feel like for it, and it has to be catchy enough for it to sort of identify itself as, okay, this is the episode theme, and it's going to be memorable because of that. We've had plenty of examples of that where that was the case with whether it was Batman the Animated Series or later with Superman the Animated Series. So I feel like this episode already, and maybe it was supposed to be the theme of the episode, but I feel like it's just pretty generic with what they ended up with as far as the soundtrack. Not to say it's bad, it's just it feels out of place for what we're used to for what the series was, and it's not catchy enough or not unique enough for me to say, okay, the music is really, really good. It feels like an odd pairing, and of no fault of its own, it may also be a victim of this already being a weird episode that feels weird, and then on top of it we have a soundtrack that doesn't match with what we're used to.
Yeah, like I said, yeah, I don't think the music is, yeah, like you said, by any means bad. I don't want to go that far, but yeah, I just feel like if this were more of a like a genre episode, if it was less of a, because like I said, I don't really feel like this deviates too much from the form as far as like a normal Batman Beyond episode. So the idea that we would have such a unique musical track to it, usually there's some element like when they do those sort of musical departures, think about Lobo showing up in Superman, and so you bring in the electric guitar when he or Livewire, and you bring in the electric guitar in a show that normally wouldn't have that. Like that makes sense to me because the character is so fits that style of music so well that of course you would have to bring in a different musical style than you're used to. Whereas here it's like the story is just like, even if the story was great, it still to me wouldn't feel like it was some sort of like genre bending episode of the series. So yeah, for all those reasons, like I said, I don't dislike the music. I think the music in a bubble, like if you were listening to this on a soundtrack, you might hear these tracks and you might love them, but as for this episode, I just don't think they fit very well, and so I ended up settling on a 5 out of 10 for music.
Nice. I went just a tick lower. I went 4 out of 10. I it's not because the quality of the music is bad. It's not because the music is by any means poor composition. It's just, it doesn't feel like it fits the tone of the episode for the majority. And I feel like if there had been some different choices to sort of maybe incorporate more of the traditional Batman Beyond drums, distorted guitar, and synthesizers, I think that that would have, especially if you introduce that and then you have this other theme maybe, and then you incorporate the horns and the flutes. And I'm not a, you know, I'm not a composer, so I don't know what the, what the likelihood of those things, and maybe it would have sounded like garbage if you had, but as an idea, sort of blending the two of those things together in some form or fashion to kind of, you know, to bring that, that flashback scene of the introduction of April and the doctor to this sort of culmination of him realizing that she's actually not at all interested in him. So that would have been my critique. That's why I gave it just a tick lower than that.
Fair enough.
All right, Liam, let's move on to our final category. Thank God for the day. And that is going to be voice acting. We have a pretty big cast, as we mentioned, even though a lot of the characters themselves didn't get named. We did have some other additional voice actors and a couple of returning actors we've heard before in the DCAU. Let's get into this week's voice cast.
That's right. We have some familiar names and maybe some that you would be surprised to hear because of the minor role. But we do have Cree Summer as Max briefly. And then as far as our guest cast, we do have Jason Nash as Bullwhip, who's an actor and a writer, actually. He's got a lot of writing credits to his name. As many as that. We also have Eric Michael Cole as Knee Jerk, as mentioned. And he doesn't, I feel bad because he's trying really hard with a dumb character. but I mean, he does a fine job. Like he's probably of the crew is probably the only one besides Bullwhip who gets more than like three lines in the episode. And that's because he has to talk to the doctor when his knee buzzsaw explodes in the first part of the episode.
Yeah, he gets to show some emotion and frustration, and it's fine. It's better than fine. It's good. It's he does what he has to do to express it, and as you mentioned, he's not given the best role to do it in. So he made lemons out of that lemonade, I guess.
Yeah, and we have Ethan Embry as Terrapin, and then as the other member, Nux, who's you mentioned, is this guy with metal boxing. Sometimes they're big boxing gloves, and sometimes they're big, they're like pistons. But either way, Nux, voiced by Johnny Galecki, who folks would know as one of the main actors on The Big Bang Theory, plays it's glasses guy on Big Bang Theory.
Yeah.
Main glass guy, the one that you know, that dates the girl on that show. I've seen like probably 30 episodes of that show.
He plays Leonard, main guy. Yeah.
Yes, I was gonna say I've probably seen about 30 episodes of that show, and I couldn't tell you anyone's name on it except for Sheldon.
Because I was gonna say he's not Sheldon. He's the main character that's not Sheldon, and he's not the other two nerdy guys. He's the guy with
right. Glasses. He's the handsome nerd, if you will. But yeah, so it's funny to see a character like that. And I guess he was a child actor too. I'm pretty sure. I think he was in that group with like Elijah Wood and Jennifer Love Hewitt and whatever that weird.
Yeah, he was on Roseanne. Disney. I believe.
Yes, yeah. You're right. I don't know if it was Disney or whoever in was like would like discover child stars and then like put them in like a house together when they were kids. I forget who that was. There's like a weird story about that you can look up. Like they didn't literally put them in a house together, but like a bunch of those like young teen and tween stars like all ended up living together and like being around each other, I guess, because that was also like, I think there was also like a special like homeschooling program for them. I heard Jennifer Love Hewitt discuss it on, I think it was Michael Rosenbaum's podcast, but anywho, fun little note to see that guy show up here. But yeah, Jason Nash as Bullwhip probably gets the most to do, as we've talked about, and he's fine, but I don't really feel like he's not overtly sinister. He's very kind of monotone, and he has a certain like sleaziness to him, but it doesn't feel like that ever like ramps up a notch.
Yeah, I think he's very understated. Like he is evil. We know that he's evil just from the beginning, and he's cocky and he's arrogant because he's got these cybernetic upgrades, and that comes across very clearly. But I feel like he needed to take it to another level of sinister once it comes out that he's also, you know, involved with the love interest of the guy that he's also holding captive. And I don't feel like, that's why I felt like at the end, it didn't feel very satisfying that he got, you know, he likely gets murdered at the end. Like it didn't feel like that was justice being served. It's just like, all right, this guy's kind of a jerk and he's really mean and he is doing these things to this guy, but also the woman is clearly mean and a jerk also. So it's two jerks that got together and, you know, screwed this doctor over. They're all kind of bad people, I guess. I don't know, but it didn't feel like he was, as you mentioned, like overtly evil. Like he's over the top sinister and he rubbing it in. Like it wasn't that level of a performance. So yeah, it's fine for what they asked of him, I guess.
Yeah, I think he does it. Like I said, I don't think there's anything particularly wrong with his performance. It's just it's kind of a, as you said, kind of a generic sort of cocky, scuzzy guy. We have Daphne Zuniga, who folks probably know best from a recurring role on One Tree Hill, playing April. Again, she doesn't get a lot to do. She has this very bizarre scene with, we'll bring him up now, the voice of Dr. Corso is Ed Begley Jr., who we've talked about a few times on this show, a very recognizable face. You may not know him by name, but if you just Google that name, you will know who this guy is.
But
has also done voices in Batman. He voiced Charlie Collins in Joker's Favor and Germs in Feet of Clay, and also provided a voice on Static Shock as well. So not only a great acting veteran, but a DCAU veteran here. It's a recognizable voice, I think, and he does a fine job as, you know, someone that's a seasoned actor would do. But again, I don't feel like there's a lot to his performance, because again, he's sort of calmly, maybe there's a little anger in his voice when he's talking to Bullwhip in that first scene. But I guess maybe the big moment for him is when he sees April and Bullwhip kissing, right? Because then he gets to do like, it's just like make weird sounds, I would love to have seen like what Andrea Romano's like direction was for that scene. It's like, all right, you've just seen the love of your life kissing another man, now make a noise that corresponds to that.
The irony is that's the noise that gives them away from outside spying at, so Batman isn't able to like do a sneak attack on this group and get them unsuspecting, and or whatever the noise is that he makes. Just hilarious.
Yeah, so that of course then brings us to our main players. We do have briefly Kevin Conroy as Bruce Wayne, and of course Will Friedle as Terry McGinnis / Batman. They're both solid. Like this is not going to make a list of memorable performances for either of those guys, but certainly nothing wrong with their performances either. I think as you sort of mentioned, the dramatic way in which Will Friedle has to keep repeating the phrase April Moon in like his tough guy Batman voice kind of made me laugh.
Yeah, that was I think unintentionally very hilarious of him. You know, in his deep, gruff Batman voice, almost gruff whispering, April Moon, like four different times. I did like that he was like super annoyance comes out as the doctor gives their position away after he sees April kissing Harold, and he gets so fed up with him and has to throw him into the like the bomb shelter. I thought that was, and his exasperation in that moment I think was great. And I do think that conversation between him and Cree Summers Max as he's sort of admitting that character, or mm-hmm. his character in those moments was stupid and an idiot for allowing himself to be overtaken, I think that's fine. It's great. I feel like this is an episode that otherwise could have not had Bruce in it if they hadn't decided, all right, this is an episode that will have Bruce in it. So I feel like that really easily could have been Cree Summer as Max doing the investigation with him. So it was nice to see the whole future Bat family sort of working together there and encouraging Terry. But yeah, it's, I think everybody there does as well as we expect them to do when it comes to performances. Nothing stood out as being memorable to me, but I think they're all good just because they all are good at what they do.
Yeah, absolutely. Yes, for all those reasons, like I said, I think everybody's fine to good. I don't think anybody's great, but I ended up settling on another 6 out of 10 for my voice acting score.
Yeah, I gave voice acting a 5 out of 10. I think everybody is just okay. I think everybody met their goals and did what was asked of them, which wasn't a whole lot, but there wasn't a performance I thought that was stand out enough for me to say, hey, this is better than just middle of the road. So I ended up giving a 5 out of 10. All right, Liam, so that brings us to our final scores for this week. So totaling everything up, this isn't a good start to 2022, because as we learned last week, if you haven't listened to that episode, you can check it out in the archives at dcaureview.com or on your favorite podcast app. We went over our highest rated episodes for the year 2021 and our lowest episodes for the year of 2021. And the lowest episode score, from my recollection, Liam, that we gave last year was an 18 out of 40. That was the single lowest score. And so far this year, our first episode that we're reviewing, I ended up with a total of 17 out of 40. So we've already surpassed our low score for last year. What about you?
Yeah. So first of all, yes, that does put us into to rarefied air, to say the least. But yes, tallying everything up, I have just a little bit higher, actually a decent bit higher. I think I was a point or two higher in almost every category compared to you. But I ended up with a final score of 21 out of 40.
All right. Do we even need to spend longer than 30 seconds on is this rewatchability? I think it's an instant skip. Burn this one.
Double thumbs down.
Yeah. Burn this one from the archives. If the next, whatever the next streaming service after HBO Max inevitably goes away in 10 years.
Whenever Disney or whoever buys.
Right.
Buys AT&T next.
Right. Whoever gets the rights to all the DC characters and does their own streaming service or wherever this moves to next, they should forget to upload this one to the streaming service so that it can begin to evaporate from the memory banks. Let's just pretend this one never exists, because it really, there's no follow-up to it. None of these characters ever return. They're not in any tie-in comics that I'm aware of. And for the better, I think.
Yeah, but you know what it, the most lasting thing is, I think on like all of the DVD art, this Terrapin character ends up on like a lot of promotional art for some reason.
Yeah,
like I want to say weird. He's in like the Batman Beyond visual guide and stuff that came out when the show was on, and then like on like, you know, the backs of the DVD sets where they would just have like random stock, you know, images from promotion, you know, promotional images from the show kind of plastered all over it. This character would end up on this, or would end up like on like the DVD menus and stuff. Like, it's really bizarre that this character, I guess it's just one that they had. Maybe they thought it looked cool and futuristic, so they'll just plaster it. But yeah, so that's probably the most lasting impact, is when he puts the robot suit on, you go, oh, that's what that's from. I thought it was like a weird alternate version of the Golem or something. No, it is in fact from a specific episode, and it's this one. So that's probably the most lasting impact that this episode has. But yeah, I would give this a double thumbs down. It's not important to Batman Beyond, nor is it important to the DCAU. So this is definitely a firm skip. I do have to ask, with a score that low, especially a plot score as low as you went, is this going into the Hall of Shame? Does this go into the bad episode jar?
Ooh, I think that it's in the discussion. I don't remember what our criteria was for it. If it had to be, it didn't have to be a single digit episode, I don't think.
No, I think we just hate, if it's just one that we like felt passionately about disliking.
Yeah, I think this is in the discussion. I think that there's not a lot to enjoy about this episode, and characters don't do the things that they should. And if I never see this episode, it would be too soon. So yeah, I think this goes into the bad episode jar at this point, because it's pretty gosh darn awful in my opinion. So I don't ever need to see it again. And boy, I thought 2022 was going to be a better year than we've had the last 2 years. And it's not starting out too good here, DCAU. So looking for hopefully some redemption next year, but or next week rather. But I guess there's always 2023 also. So. All right, Liam. Well, that will begin to wrap things up for this week. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. Don't forget to subscribe to us on your favorite podcast app. As we mentioned, you can also check out the full archives of the DCAU Review at dcaureview.com or on your favorite podcast app. If you'd like to support the pod, you have a couple ways that you can do that. You can subscribe to us on your favorite podcast app. If your podcast app, such as Apple Podcasts, allows you to leave a review, you can do so. We would love a 5-star review. More importantly, if you can leave a little paragraph letting people know what it is you appreciate and enjoy about the podcast, that would be very helpful and supportive as well. You can also, if you wish to support us in a way that is monetary, you can do that a couple different ways. We have a link at the bottom of all of our podcasts. You can click on that, sort of like a Patreon type thing. If you just want to donate, that's incredible. We have a couple people that do that and it's very kind. And we love you guys for doing so. So shout out to you guys that support the pod that way. If you want something for your dollar, you can check out the podcast store, head over to dcaureview.com, click on the store. You can get yourself some merch. There's usually some sales that happen around holidays. So save your dollars and wait, follow Liam on, the DCAU Review on Twitter at DCAU Review. And of course on Instagram at DCAU Review, we'll usually post when those sales go up to give you the cheapest way possible to support us, but we appreciate that. And if you're looking for another free way to support us, go over to the Pod Tower on YouTube, head over to YouTube, search Pod Tower, and then subscribe to it. That's a free way to do so. You get our podcast, the complete archive is available there in video YouTube form. You can check those out. New episodes are uploaded every single week. And then, of course, you also get content from our friends over at Watchtower Database, as well as Tim Talk. Liam, we're going to be continuing next week here in the future with Batman Beyond with yet another episode. So let's preview that episode right now.
That is right, Cal. We'll be back with another Batman Beyond episode next week. And that one will be another, I think this one also memorable, at least from a basic plot synopsis standpoint. But next week we will be talking about Centuries of the Last Cosmos.
Oh, interesting. But less said about that before we review it, the better. I think we're headed into some of these interesting episodes. So it's going to be an interesting rest of the month.
Yeah, we at least got some Easter eggs for Star Wars and then probably even some Trekkie stuff in there. So hopefully there will at least be a little bit more to talk about beyond what we didn't like on like this week's episode.
That's right. And don't forget, check out our bonus episode that we released earlier this week. We dropped our final episode of coverage, at least for the time being, for Justice League Infinity, which of course is the tie-in comic book that follows up everything that happened immediately after Justice League Unlimited. You don't want to miss that exciting conclusion. So check that out. Also available on your favorite podcast app and on the Pod Tower on YouTube and at dcaureview.com. But until next week, I'm Cal.
I'm Liam.
And we'll talk to you on the next episode of the DCAU.
Bye-bye.